have not been involved with the game system very long. Can you give us a little background about how you get involved in it and how many games you've involved in the design of?
Do you want to go for that now prior to the official?
Yeah, we'll talk about that now. We'll have something to talk about. And then when everybody gets online, we'll be set to start right at 8:30. Okay.
Okay. Well, I started maybe 2-3 years after Joe, but I started just as a player for the first 4 or 5 years. I picked up a copy of Stonewall Jackson's Way when I was at what was then Avalon Con. The very second Avalon Con up at Camp Hill, Pennsylvania, was where Stonewall Jackson's Way came out. And I picked up a copy at the store. And that was, I'd kind of not really been in Hex Encounter wargaming for a while. I'd done a lot of that when I was a teenager, but it'd been a few years. But the maps and the Civil War history that I was pretty familiar with kind of sucked me right in real quick. So I played the next year in the very first tournament that we ever had in the series when that convention moved to Hunt Valley. Mm-hmm. And Joe was our game master then, and we played the Cedar Mountain scenario. And I had studied that thing so carefully that I did very well and I won that tournament.
As you've won 6 other times, by the way, I would point
out. I've got a few plaques up on the wall for it. But what really was sort of, inspirational for me was I noticed that the map area there on the Stonewall Jackson's Way map covered the ground for my favorite campaign, which was Chancellorsville. And so we had a meet and greet the designer at, I believe, that first Avalon Con in Hunt Valley. And we chatted with Joe, and I asked him if he was going to ever do Chancellorsville. And smartly, he and Avalon Hill were like, well, we really need to extend the map area. So the more games we can do that have brand new map that plugs in, each one of those games is going to be very attractive to their customers. So we're probably not going to do Chancellorsville because it just uses existing maps. So I said, well, what if I try to work on some scenarios for that and maybe we can publish them in the general? And we were trying to put them in the magazine, but I actually got far enough in on it that Joe encouraged me to try to make that into a standalone box game. And therefore, the whole idea for Stonewall's Last Battle was born. And we did put it out as my first published game design in 1995 with plenty of help and consulting from to get me there to the finish line. But that was kind of how I got started.
And there's a question for you and Joe together. How do you guys go about finding all the detail about troop strengths and locations and all that? Because I've had trouble with that over the years, trying to figure out where everybody was, especially if they weren't directly involved in a battle or something like that.
Joe, you want to start with that?
Sure. I mean, overwhelmingly, the official records, I'm sure you're familiar with that, Ken. I mean, right. The official records is essentially the Bible for anything you do on Civil War gaming. And I mean, the information can be so intense that it's overwhelming, but, you know, almost everything you need to know comes from the official records, and what you can't find there, you can find with a good treasure hunt and other sources. I'm sure Ed would agree with that.
Yeah, the official records are absolutely fantastic. The only problem is it sort of takes snapshots in time, especially mm-hmm. if you're going for troop strength. So it's like right before the campaign started, they have all their units, you know, muster out and tally up their men and submit official reports. So you might get it on one date, and then you might not have another report for that, like that, for 2 or 3 weeks. So you end up, I think the positioning I thought was going to be hard, but that's actually probably easier than trying to figure out the exact troop strengths at any given day of the campaign. You have to go and sort of back out losses from battles and marches and so forth and try to they started with 8,000 men at the beginning of the campaign, but I saw they lost 500 here and 1,000 there. And so you just do the subtraction and come out with what you think they should have.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. And of course it depends on the side. The information on the Confederate side is never as sophisticated as on the Union side. And I learned that the hard way coming back with Hood strikes north. You know, troop strengths on Hood's army in the Nashville campaign are very, very tenuous. You know, a lot of guesswork is involved in there. But the official records are your basic skeleton. And, yeah, as Ed said, you have to interpolate, you know, based on what time you're looking at in the campaign. Based on what's happened in, you know, in the past. And Chris Withers is very good at that. You know, he did a couple of the scenarios. He did the Franklin scenario and the Battle of Nashville scenario. And he pretty much figured out how much Hood had lost since the start of the campaign. And I would trust those numbers. And anyway, it's always a fun challenge. I mean, that's one of the great joys of game design is you know, the research is always a challenge, always intriguing, and always fun.
So then, Ed, you got involved in Stonewall Jackson's Way. I mean, Stonewall's Last Battle. And then after that, you took on to Richmond, correct?
Well, Joe was working on Onto Richmond, and by that point we'd had three or four tournaments, I think, and we were starting to get a group of us who were spending a lot of time looking at basic game scenario balance to make those scenarios as competitive as we possibly could for tournament play. So I started out just sort of offering my services as Joe was working on Onto Richmond to ask him if he wanted me to work with those basic scenarios and go for trying to fine tune them for tournament play. And there are a couple from Onto Richmond that we still really like for tournament play. Now that game's been out of print so long that we don't actually use it in tournaments right now. And it'll be when Onto Richmond 2 gets published soon that we go back to some of those, but like the Seven Pines scenario for years was considered, you know, one of the best scenarios for tournament play in the whole series. And that was kind of, I did some play testing on the campaign game for Onto Richmond, but Joe did almost all the campaign game work there. And it was mostly basic game scenarios that I collaborated with him on for Onto Richmond.
Yeah. And believe it or not, after all these years, I'm actually playing my first full campaign game Onto Richmond with Tebow on Vassal. And really enjoying it. It's really a neat game because of the amphibious movement and the need to clear the rivers up. There's so many things going on. You've got to do in the valley in Norfolk and even down to the Virginia and the Monitor. And so we're having a good time. So I'm anxious to get the new, although the maps are difficult to deal with. they're so dark on the Vassal module. You can't figure out whether there's actually a landing there or not. So I heard the new maps are going to be wonderful.
You would cry if you could see the map that's on my computer right now, because Charlie sent me a full single file that has both of the new copies of the Onto Richmond map and the new two new Grant Takes Command maps and the Stonewall Jackson's Way South map. All five of those I have in one Photoshop file that I can turn layers on and off of. And right now we're checking to make sure that the map alignment for things like roads along the edges of maps and things like that are, we found that there are a couple places where roads don't either line up, or we like in one of those half hexes at the edge of the map, we didn't extend a road off one of the maps. Mm-hmm. So we're fixing things like that. So they're not quite ready for prime time, but boy, they're awfully close and they look gorgeous. So sometime in the near future, we should figure out a way to, you know, share those with the community, either, you know, in a quick little online session where I could share a screen of them, or maybe we post snippets of them. But they're really exciting, especially because we now have a full set of 1864 fortifications around both Richmond and Petersburg. So you can really see, you know, how Grant's move across the river is going to unfold and what kind of defensive lines were there waiting for him and not there waiting for him. And so it's going to be really exciting when everyone sees all that.
Mm-hmm. Good, good. So we also have Mark Booth on the line here, who I touted as the number one ranked player in the world on our area rating. and before we get started here, Mark, can you tell everybody a little bit about how long you've been playing the game and how you got involved?
Sure. I picked up Stonewall Jackson's Way at my local gaming store back in the mid-90s, so it's been a while. I was really intrigued by it, played it online with someone shortly thereafter using the old email exchange move technique. It worked. I thought I knew the rules, my short story, but one I didn't was that I didn't know how many dice you rolled for combat. I thought you rolled, each player rolled two dice for combat, and fortunately my first opponent moved first, or it would have been embarrassing, but like, how do you get these plus eight or plus nines in the combat chart with only rolling one die each? So clearly I had a lot to learn. I went to one of the Avalon cons shortly thereafter and started learning the strategies from other players. Basically just been playing ever since. Lately, I've been running the Board Game Players Association online tournament, which is started with about 35, 40 players, is just about down to the semifinals now, the final four, which does include Ed and Ken. And so that's where I stand. That's my basic bio.
Will you be running that again in the near future? Are you going to start another one up right away, or are you going to take some time off?
We shall see.
Okay. One thing I will be putting out pretty soon is every summer we run a Mason Dixon Cup online, where we have a number of players all play either on the Union side or the Confederate side, and scenarios from one of the games in the system. So we're going to be starting that up relatively shortly here. So anybody that's listening in tonight, you're welcome to join us. And what we do is we ask people what their experience level is and how long a scenario they want to play. We try to match you up with the person who will be a good game match for you. So, okay. So that's a little bit of intro. Ed and Mark, thanks for joining us tonight. We've set up the, I'm assuming everybody is on the Vassal server seeing the game set up. I just took the liberty of putting some manpower markers on the board to demonstrate the victory points associated with getting to certain objectives. And the basic idea of this, it's a cavalry raid scenario, and you've got Kilpatrick's cavalry. He's got to get over here. He's got to burn a number of these stations, got to build up at least, I guess, only 6 points. So he's just got to basically get to one of those stations, and he's got to get at least to one of the ones on the Macon or Western Railroad, or he'll get a minus 6 points. And then the most difficult thing is, though, he's then got to get back all the way back either to Sandtown or to Decatur, which is north of Atlanta there. So with that, I will turn it over to Ed and Mark to play the game.
All right. You start with the leader transfer phase.
Yeah, you had me scared, Ken, when I looked at the setup and all of a sudden there were these 9 strength units.
And the Union can get, do I understand correctly, the Union, if they get to get back home safely, they can also, you know, in addition to Sandtown, just get anywhere north of the Chattahoochee, so anywhere to the left on the map of the Chattahoochee. So lots of options for them there.
And so, I'm under restriction, so I can only move one unit on this first turn, which is Ross. And he's the one that seems to be right in the way of Kilpatrick. So I guess we're going to roll for a nit, but it's just going to be kind of him versus Kilpatrick.
You can leader transfer if you want. The Union has none. You can. They're all together. Jackson can.
And just to remind you, if you both roll a 1 or both roll a 6 when you're determining initiative, after you've had one initiative, there could be one turn of late rain. So just to remind you of that. So go ahead. Sorry.
On the Union. I don't want that.
Okay. Well, there's nothing prohibiting. And just so everyone is aware, I have not played this scenario before. I don't believe Mark has either. So we kind of thought that would be make for a really kind of ideal demonstration game, because we will have to sort of decompose how we were reading the scenario sort of live on the fly. So if we sound like we're just learning things for the first time about the scenario, that's because we actually are.
Ditto here. I looked at things and couldn't see how the Rebs do it.
Yeah, it looks like there's no prohibition against me transferring Jackson to Ross.
Right.
So I will go ahead and do that. Now, because of the way the leader transfer rules work, if he ends up 10 hexes away from the other units of Jackson's command at the end of the first turn here, he will not be able to transfer back to them. So I think what I'll probably do is move him over, but I'm going to have to think real carefully about how far Ross is ending up away from Armstrong, because I might not want to make that as far as 10 hexes, because I think it's going to be really useful to have Jackson bring up Armstrong and Ferguson on the second turn. But I'll go ahead and make that transfer now. Okay, and so I guess we're ready for the first init roll, if you want to do that, Mark.
All right, here we go. Who's who now? Which is the white die?
Well, I think we're going to stick with our usual play-by-email convention, and the Union will always be the first die, and the Confederate will always be the second.
All right. First roll.
So that's mine.
Six. It's you.
So I only have one person I can move, so that's pretty easy. I'll go ahead and take Ross and bump him up a fatigue level. And let's roll dice, and I'll see what my options are. Okay, so he's got 9, and as a Confederate cavalry division leader, that's plus 2 more, so I can move him 11 movement points. So I find these cavalry scenarios, they're really my favorite. I love it because it's a huge positional play type of game. The one I've played the most is Sheridan Ride South from Grand Takes Command. We've used that in tournaments for years. And the Confederate in that one, it's just a matter of trying to figure out enough ways that you can delay your opponent, just to slow him down enough to prevent him from scoring the victory points he needs. And so that's really what my strategy is going to be here, is come up with the best possible places to delay Mark and make sure that, he's going to have to like take extra moves to get around me, or put his units at risk and make a, push them too hard, those kind of things. As long as I can do that, then I think I'll be in good shape here. So with only one unit here, I have very limited options for this particular turn, but I do notice that the movement restrictions means the Union can't get very close to East Point. And then I have this nice stretch of woods running south of East Point, just above where Jackson is. And so those are going to form some nice natural barriers for him. Now, the one thing that you have to keep in mind with cavalry forces like this is the one thing you don't want to do with your forces is put them in a position where they might suffer retreat losses in combat, because one retreat loss in combat, especially given how small the units are here, that will kill them entirely. So you want to put your units at crossroads, and that gives them lots of different directions that they can retreat. And it makes it much, much tougher for them to get destroyed in a combat situation. But we do have the advantage here, as defending against Kilpatrick, that Kilpatrick is only a division leader, not a corps leader. So if he activates multiple units, only the first one can attack. And that makes it a lot harder for Mark to go ahead and surround folks. So let me think. It actually would have been a decent option. I've already rolled for movement, so I can't take it now, to consider building an abattis on my current location, because it's in a pretty good blocking position I'm in right now. But let's see what else I can do that might be even better. Now, I do have one point of artillery. So if I can get out into... as long as I stay in a nice clear or rolling hex, I'm going to have a minus one combat modifier against him for that. So Fairburn Station's worth two. Not sure if that's going to be worth him stopping at or not. But I noticed that the road network here is not his friend. And if I don't let him come up this route from Bethesda Church, he's going to be going a lot further around than maybe necessary. So I think getting over and blocking that route might be the best way to go. So for instance, if I move to here, I'm still within 10 of Armstrong for the leader transfer phase. And now I'm going to force him to either attack me or come up this more northern route. It's going to definitely probably cost him another move. So I'm going to move there. That's my first move, Mark.
All right.
All right. So I'll go ahead and roll initiative. Usually in tournament play, we always have whoever sort of like punching the checks clock. When you're done your move, you roll the init dice, and that signals to everybody that you're done with that move. So I'll do that now. And Mark wins initiative.
All right. So if it weren't for rain, I might move my units in a couple groups or whatever. But I am worried about rain. I got to get these guys moving. I'm going to move them all together. So Kilpatrick will activate all five of his units. He can activate all of them. Here's movement roll. 10, 11. Glad I didn't wait and hold off. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10, and 11. So yes, the road network is a little difficult here. Let's see, where is my weakest unit? My weakest unit is Jones. I'm going to have him go up adjacent to Jackson's. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And what about the other ones? He will join Long. I think they'll all join Long. Kilpatrick will move with the stack. See if we can get around, see if we get lucky, get the next initiative and get behind Jackson and Ross on the next initiative. All right, they all there, they all have fatigue markers. Next initiative is a high tie. A high tie goes to the Rebs, right?
Yes, it does. Okay, so Mark has committed to kind of going that northern route. And looks like he's going to want to move through 3823 King or Shields and get up through this 3921 Cole area. So I think I'm going to go ahead and roll for movement, see what I get, and see if I have an option to get up there and block him. So here's my movement roll. Plus two again for being a Confederate cavalry unit. And not a good roll at all. So, well, I've got to take a fatigue level, so I might as well mark that. So I could move up to Russell. That'd be where my movement would end here. one extra movement point to leave Jones's zone of control, and then so that's two to this first hex, and there would be five up to Russell. That is a dangerous spot, though, because there are only two roads leading into it. So he could pretty easily come at me from two directions and wipe my unit out. Especially since that's my only unit I can move this turn, that just seems exceptionally dangerous. So I think what I'm going to do is just retreat back one hex to disengage. And then if I get the next initiative, then that nice Bethesda church hex is calling my name. But if I don't get it, I'll probably just let Kilpatrick and his units on through and have to deal with him on the flip side. Okay, so we're going to roll a knit. And it's mine again. Okay, so going to fatigue level 3, we will roll movement first. Okay, I don't need very much movement, so that's okay. And then the extended march roll, a 5, which is just safe for cavalry at this part in the war, so I'm okay. So I'm going to come up to Bethesda Church and notice that's only 8 from Armstrong, so I could transfer back to him at the start of the next turn if I needed to. And so it's going to make Kilpatrick, who's gone up north, he's probably going to, probably going to have to come back south, maybe go this way, or come through me, one or the other. So at least I'm costing him some movement points. So hopefully that's enough. So we're rolling it again. It is mine. So I have a choice now. I can either entrench, or I can pass. And I think I'm going to actually go ahead and entrench, because I really can't imagine I want to move him again. And that just seems like a prudent thing to do. It's going to discourage Mark from getting too frisky and try to attack me here. So the Abati is in place, and I'm done for the turn. Mark can finish the turn out.
All right, I will activate. Kilpatrick will activate all 5 of his units. Jones is still in his command radius. Here's movement roll. 4 plus 1 from my division leader's 5. So my plan was to sort of forget about Fairburn and just go for the big ticket items, the big 3 railroad stations. All right, so let's see. We'll march Jones first. Goes up to fatigue 2. Okay, so I have 5 movement points.
Mark, I'll go ahead and fatigue the other units for you. You don't mind?
Oh, please. Thank you.
Okay.
That's 5. The other ones will be 3 behind the 13. I could try to slip through to the north, although I don't have a road at one point. I'd be tempting Jackson to go to fatigue 4 to try to block him if I did that with a whole lot of my forces.
He's already at fatigue 4 because I entrenched him.
Oh, you entrenched him. Thank you. Thank you. Yep. It really is my turn to go. Thank
you.
All right, then. We will, keeping all the forces together, they will all move up to Cole here, 5 hexes away. Right to there, 1, 2, 3, 5 hexes. All at fatigue 2. My plan has always been to push these guys to at least fatigue 3 on the first turn, as long as there's no rain. All right. While the board is pretty far open. Okay, next initiative is mine still, although I guess it is technically Do I have to roll?
Yeah, probably because the rain possibility.
There's the rain chance, so I should probably roll for each initiative. All right, so Kilpatrick is going to activate all the four units within his command radius. Jones is far away now. See how far these guys, see how far they get. I wonder if now is a good time to try my two at a time, get some of these folks to at least get a good roll. Yeah, why don't I try that? So let's see, how about Kilpatrick with his second division brigades of Long and Minty. Long and Minty are going to march here from Kilpatrick. Here's the movement roll. 6 plus 1 is 7. So just those two. Kilpatrick's going to stay back, march the other guys on his own. Next initiative. So Long, let's get him out. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Oh, I do have to roll for extend march. Sorry about that. And Kilpatrick is staying back. That's announced already. So here's extend march. He's fine. And then the next unit of the second division, Minty, right? There we go. He'll go on top. All right, I'm getting better. All right, he'll join. All right.
Extend march.
And next, oh yes, thank you. The second one, extend march, is also okay. As long as I can actually click it. It's a 2. Did I get that second extend march? All right, then. Is that a double?
Yeah, it's a whole new, yep. So
that's the initiative roll.
And your game master, which does that count as the initiative roll, or did he re-roll everything?
That would be his next roll, so I would say that's the initiative roll.
So late rain occurred?
Yep, rain.
Okay, well, the double ones is good for me either way then.
Exactly. It's raining. Fatigue 3. I definitely will not be going to fatigue 4. All right, so... my initiative still here. Those two units will, of course, I suppose now I have the option to pass if I want.
Yeah, that'd be legitimate. It might make a lot of sense too.
Yeah, I think I will pass, which will make Ken put those F3s back to F2s.
Got it.
He's better at this than I am.
Okay.
Let's see. So I still have Jones down there, but in the rain, no thank you. But at least that means I won't have rain in turns 2 through 5. So that's not so terrible. All right. I think I will pass from here.
Okay. We're ready for recovery.
Go ahead, Ed. Push for recovery.
You want me to do it?
Yep. Go ahead.
Okay. So we're up for leader transfer on turn 2. Is that correct?
Correct.
You go first, because you're the Union.
I do. I'm going to live dangerously and hope for an early init or two, so I will not transfer.
Okay. And as I've been talking about, Jackson's going to transfer back to Armstrong. And then I'm going to wait for you to roll the first init to be Confederate.
All right. Here we go. First initiative is Union. So Kilpatrick will now activate Klein and Murray to start things off here. Units he's with. Here's their movement. 6 plus 1, 7 movement points. Both go to fatigue 1. Need to move them as a stack. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. risking being blocked there, hanging out in the woods with not much maneuvering room, but at least they're within command radius of the Minty, the second division units there. All right, so my units of fatigue one. Next initiative. To the Rebs.
Okay, so it's a little high risk, high reward, but it's really clear to me that what I want to try to do is get Rebs onto this battlefield using some railroad movement. It's really the only way he's going to get into battle. And I was actually a little worried about Mark that he might activate Minty's stack first and go ahead and claim the rail line to block this. So we're going to go ahead. It takes one fatigue to embark him for railroad movement. If Ken wants to find the railroad embarkment counter somewhere in here, I'd be happy to have him do that. But otherwise, I'm just going to roll the next init and hope that I get it. And it's a high die roll, so that is a Confederate init. So I can move him along the rail, and for every 13 X I move, I take one. So I'll probably want to move him 26 spaces, and we'll see where that ends up. 13 spaces to quick station. Okay, so I can either put him in Jonesboro or I can get him somewhere down here near Crawford for two fatigue levels. And I don't think he has to make an extended march check, so he will be there with his two... Oh, he's only a one-man power unit. So he's not as effective a block as I was hoping. Still, Jonesboro is nice because of the way this woods works here. It's going to be extremely difficult for Mark to get a flank bonus against that. So we're going to go ahead and we will use the rail movement. We're going to go to Jonesboro, take our rail movement off, and add two fatigue levels. All right, so there's something in his way at least now. And next initiative. Mine again. So I think I've got several options. I can add Nabatis to Reynolds, which would put him up to a combat strength of 1.5. I could flank refuse him so that he probably would only get a +1 flank bonus against him. Or I could try to move Ross over to reinforce him. But Mark's got the roads blocked against that move pretty effectively. And Jackson's either going to have to roll boxcars to make it there in one move, or he's going to take two movements. So I'm not trusting myself to win two init here. So let me put the flank. Okay, well, no, wait a second. If I put the flank refuse marker on, I have to roll for an extended march, and there's a 1/3 chance I'll flip over and only be a half strength. So that is riskier than I want to play it, and I'm just going to entrench him instead. All right. So I have dug in Confederate infantry blocking Kilpatrick at Jonesboro. Not impressive dug in Confederate infantry, but it's there. All right, so the next init. And another one. All right, well, now it's time for my cavalry to get into the action. And I think the way I want to do this is, if I just move Jackson, then Ferguson would be left behind with no movement bonus. So I would love to get my cavalry moving in some kind of coordinated fashion. So I'm going to start with that trailing unit, Ferguson, and Ferguson's movement will be 7. He's Confederate, so he gets 8 movement points. You can get the rough and ready. Or I could just put him 3 ahead of Jackson so they can move together, and I think that's what I'll do. All right. Go for knit again. I'm getting very fortunate here. All right, so Jackson's activating both those cavalry brigades. And I've got 12 movement points. All right, now what I'm going to do, I've rolled movement, so since I have a leader who's activating more than one unit at a time, before I move anyone, I have to designate which unit the leader is going to travel with. So Jackson's going to transfer ahead to Ferguson. He will go to fatigue 2. Armstrong will go to fatigue 1. And I'll start by moving Jackson 12 hexes. I think if I follow the rail line, that puts me nicely in Jonesboro. 2. And it does. And then Armstrong's job is going to be, since I didn't put up that flank refuse marker, to try to guard my flank so that the Union can't get a flank bonus against me. So we'll go 12 down the road again with him. 2, 4, 6. And 6 more, 2, 4. Oops. I flipped over all those counters. Okay. Yeah, and he started in East Point, so that's correct. All right, well, that looks very promising. So, Kenley, why not use Ferguson to get the flank refused? I could, if I didn't have Armstrong right there helping protect the flank, but at the moment, I'm not too worried about a flank bonus. Cavalry against cavalry, well, I guess I got infantry there, so it would be cavalry on infantry. He could get maybe a +2 flank bonus against it, but he's got to work hard against it. If I put up the flank refuse, then he gets a +1 bonus just for attacking me straight on. So,
and your infantry, I think, is less than half of your... Infantry is less than half of your force in there. So would that mean that it's a cav on cav with the limited flanks?
I don't think so, but I don't know. Somebody can double check that on us. But I'll go with it.
Probably not going to come into play.
Yeah. All right. So next initiative. Will I get initiative again? Well, now I have to try to anticipate what Mark's going to do next. So I think I likely forced him to head down to Lovejoy Station because I guess if he gets Morrow Station and Fairburn, he has enough victory points for a win. Assuming everybody gets back and he doesn't take
a narrow victory.
Yeah. I also like the way that Kilpatrick's movement path directly in front of him has been blocked by my units now. So he's going to have to take a detour. If I can get somebody into this area south of where he is, you know, like move Ross in there, then that's going to make it even more painful. Or I can move Armstrong down there. He's actually much more likely to make it in a single move. And he has an artillery strike. Yeah, I'm going to have Jackson activate Armstrong. We'll see what movement we get. And because he's a leader activating units within three, I could actually also activate Ferguson again and have him also put up a Vadis. Would not come to F3. But I think that's worth it. So Jackson's going to activate Armstrong for movement. Ferguson to entrench. Here's the movement roll. So that'll be 8. Question is where to move him. If it's great for me to get him right in here because that's going to slow Kilpatrick down even further. This hex here, there are only 3 roads leading into it, which just sort of automatically makes it more dangerous than this one, which has 4. A safer play would just be to block this next bridge and just force him to go down to Fayetteville. Yep, I'm going to put him here. All right, next initiative. Now Mark gets to go.
All right. Making me wish that I had moved along into Jonesboro while I had the chance, although he may have been blasted out by now. I don't know. So, yes, I'm well contained. My units don't have much maneuvering room. I can bring, they've pretty much established their perimeter. I might expect them not to be moving much from now on. I could try to bring Jones up from the rear and get around Armstrong and maybe do some damage there. At least force Armstrong to back off. Or I could move Kilpatrick and his calves to the north, the roundabout route, go to Lovejoy. Why don't we bring Jones up? He hasn't moved in a while. So Jones down to the south, my trailing unit. So just Jones, he's got no leader, has no leader with him. So here's his movement. 7, and 7 it is. Jones just close to Fairburn. Down there in 4225, I get 7 movement points. 1, 2, that's easy. Now where? Three, four, 5, 6, 7. Ideally, I would have been that hex 1 to the upper right, but that will do. All right, next initiative is to the Rebs.
This is interesting because Jones is in a slightly dangerous position, and I could come up behind him, but I'd have to have Ross give up his entrenched position here, which is slowing Kilpatrick down from coming back around this way. But I think at this point I'm okay with Kilpatrick having to feint left and then go right. That's going to take him more time. So I'm going to go ahead and activate Ross here. So he's got 10 movement points. He went all the way to F4 last time. So he's going to have to make an extended march check, even though he's only going to fatigue level 2. He's okay. And I have exactly 10 movement points to go. 2, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So that's what I'm going to try to do. If I win the next init, Armstrong can attack Jones, I'll have a +2 flank bonus. And if he has to take a loss, if he has to retreat, he'll take a retreat loss. So that's what I'm hoping. All right, so the next initiative roll.
It's low ties.
High, low number, so that's marks.
All right, so yes. Don't like this. Jones, my weakest unit, being surrounded here. Currently a +2 surround with the Cavs. Looks like a +5 attack if Armstrong can get a prepared attack off, maybe roughly. I could refuse flanks, but that would just drop it down by 1. Or I can try to knock Armstrong out.
I think I'd have to get transfer Jackson over to get a +5, I think. Not sure if I want to have him leave Jonesboro, but it's still a nice attack.
I'd have to go across the road if I were doing the Kilpatrick activation. So that's going to make it very hard to get any sort of probably even a normal attack against Armstrong. So I'm going to activate Jones. It's going to try to up to fatigue 2. He does not have any good road network to get out of here, which is going to be unfortunate. So Jones is going to just move 1 hex, so I will not, that's all he can move. So I'm not going to roll. He's going to move across zone to zone here. So he's going to have to, in this move here, come back here. This move here, it's zone to zone without the benefit of a road or railroad. So he's going to have to disorganize in doing that. So he's going to have to flip, which is the cost of having been surrounded there. It's going to make it easier to attack him the next time around. But anyway, that's where Jones is ending up. Closer to, at least he's in Kilpatrick's command radius now. All right, did I do that all correctly? To the next initiative. So it's to the Rebs.
And I will pass.
All right. Now I have to be careful with Jones. If he goes to fatigue 3, he has to roll for an extend march, and if he fails his extend march roll, he's eliminated, and that means an automatic loss of 3 points. So I might as well make the Rebs work for it, since I won't be able to get him back, and of course I won't lose anything from the manpower losses. But so let's see. I think Kilpatrick will activate his 4 units that are within his immediate zone here, other than Jones. So the 4 units adjacent to Kilpatrick. So here we go for Klein and et cetera, et cetera. Murray, Minty, and Long. All right, here's their movement. 9. So I can't complain about movement rolls. They get 10 movement points. I think I see where I want them all to be. I'm going to need another initiative after this one, or I risk being blocked again if I go the northern route. But that does appear to be the only open road to go to Lovejoy. Otherwise, I'm stuck with the Burn Morrow station and try to get Fairburn on the way back. And I don't like either of those, that option at all. I want to get the big ticket items and make the Rebs do some more movement, maybe abandon one of the railroads, and maybe I can come back and get one afterwards. All right, so I got a lot of movement points. All right, so let's march the top group here. So 1 to there. 4. Seven, 8, 9, 10.
I think you get 1 more movement point if you followed the road up around by Mars Station.
Oh, yes, you're right. You're right. I didn't see that. That's not prohibited hex, that those ones right next to Mars Station. That's, thank you. One more. Kilpatrick will follow on top. I'm tempted to move one hex above Murray to give him a little maneuvering room in case you try to block me, but he does move him out of his way a couple of hexes, which I don't like that idea. So all in there. All right, and then the other group, which unfortunately are not, they just go to fatigue one, but they have much more limited movement zone, I think. I'm not even sure they're going to be able to stay within Kilpatrick's command radius.
They can just, the way I'm counting it, but they'll be three behind.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you're right. They can move to 4616. I'll move them as a stack to save time. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Thank you. All right. Both of fatigue two. Oh, both of fatigue one. They would have had to roll for extend march of fatigue two. All right. Next initiative. It's back to the Union. All right. I stand a chance to get into Lovejoy. I guess I'm not going to make the same mistake again. So I'm going to try to get to the station if I can. So Kilpatrick is going to activate. I'm not going to worry about Jones, and I'm going to get Kilpatrick's four units as close to Lovejoy as possible. So Kilpatrick will activate all four of the units in his command radius. So here's movement. 5 plus 1 is 6. I think I fall one short. All right, the first group. All right. My first group is going to have to extend march. So I'm going to have to declare where Kilpatrick is, if he's going to transfer at all here before I start rolling for extend march rolls here. Not sure it makes much difference. Okay, Kilpatrick is going to stay with his frontline units here. So Murray is going to march first. He's my big guy in the front of the line. So here's his extend march roll for Murray. Anything but a 6, of course. Did I really roll that? I did. It's a 1, so he's okay. So Murray comes out at F3. I wish I had gotten one more movement point. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then Klein, his movement, his extend roll, a 3. He's good, so I'm fortunate there. So he'll join Kilpatrick. Long is going to march first, the second group. So he's going to F2, but he's exhausted, so he's going to have to roll for extend march. Here's extend march, a 5. So he's okay, barely. Goes to fatigue 2. Now for him, I wonder if it's going to make sense to try a minor blocking areas. I wonder if the...
Go to Noah's Arch. Noah's Ark Church. That sounds like an awesome place to visit.
I was going to stop there temporarily. And keep moving down to Helm, maybe. Well, I guess I was going to bypass the church. Why don't I do that? I'm not sure. Maybe that's the best move or not, but hey. Long. There's 1 for Long. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So So at least still Forrest Armstrong to Ross to go the long way around, and Jackson Ferguson, although he's not likely to leave his abattis there. They are now out along his outside of command radius, which is unfortunate, but that's the way it goes. And then Minty, he's going to go to fatigue two. So here's his extend march roll. He flips. So I'm going to have to worry about him for a while, the rest of the game, probably, until unless I get him back unexhausted again. One, two, three, four, five, six. How's that? I suppose I perhaps should have been more foresightful and put Minty in there with Kilpatrick, but I'm not that smart. All right. So next initiative. Here we go. It's a high tie is Threbs.
And there's six, no...
But we've already had rain, fortunately.
Right. So there's no late rain.
No second day of rain.
Okay, so I guess let's take a quick Confederate look at the situation. It may be tough for me to stop him. It's certainly going to be tough for me to stop him from burning Lovejoy Station. It might be tough for me to stop him from getting Lovejoy and Bear Creek, which is 18 points. But I think what I do have is if he's got to go all the way to Bear Creek Station, he's going to have quite a journey home. And if I can get those victory points for cavalry, Union cavalry brigades that are not back where they need to be at the end of the scenario, even if he gets both those stations, I might be okay. So what I'm going to try to do is go ahead and take a swipe at Jones and see if I can get that one last manpower off of him so that I can... consider him, Mark would have to consider him a loss. So I think the interesting thing is I already have flank coverage against three of his hexes, and if Jackson can come down here through 4421, I can get all six hexes against him. So I'm going to activate Jackson, activating Ferguson, and we're going to hope for a nice movement roll. If we don't get it, I'm not sure what I'm going to do, but we're going to see what happens. Here's movement. And that's 11. So that's pretty nice. And then I'll do my extended march check. And he's going to flip, I believe. He's going to fatigue four. But we'll want to go ahead and take this shot. That's 2, 4, 5 movement points to here out of the 11 I had total. So I have 6 left. So that's enough for just a normal attack. Unfortunately, the 4-1 odds I would have had just dropped to 2-1 because of the extended march roll. So it's a +1 for odds, a +1 for tactical, and a +2 more for flank. So I'm getting that as a +4 attack. Does that look right to you, Mark?
Yep, that's what I see.
So I'm actually going to have to beat him by 1 on the die roll to get up into the +5 column to cause the manpower loss on the combat chart, but I'm going to hope that happens. So here are the combat dice. And again, it's always Union, then Confederate. I got exactly what I needed.
5.
So it's a +5, which
gone.
Is, yep, a 1DR, and that's going to eliminate Jones. So... I will go ahead and advance in just to keep all of Jackson's cavalry there together. And that's it for that initiative. So we'll roll the next hit. That's yours, Mark.
All right. Let's see. So now I lose 3 victory points for not being able to get
Jones. Yeah, maybe we need some markers on the victory points back again.
And I lose, right, and I lose 2. I'm down 2 from the combat loss. That's a -5 in total so far. But yes, we need to keep track.
I got it.
So that means I can get 9 for burning Lovejoy. And then even if I get everybody back, my 4 remaining units, I'm still a couple of victory points short. I could try to maybe get a fair burn or do something, or maybe get a casualty loss on the Rebs, but I'll have to do something more. All right.
Yeah, that is true that Jonesboro, or Lovejoy's now, and then Fairburn on the way back would be enough.
Mm-hmm. So I'm going to take a shot with Long, who's on his own without a leader. He's going to go to F3, so he's going to have to roll for extend march roll. He's going to activate all on his lonesome and go to fatigue 3 out here in the woods. So to fatigue 3, so I'll do his march roll first. So here's his march roll. 9, so that's, I like that. And now I have to roll for extend march. I'm going to roll 1 die for him. Anything from 1 to a 4, he fails. Serves me right. All right. So he flips. So he can't do a burn on his own anymore. I wonder if I want to try to be clever and keep him going to Bear Creek, which is living dangerously. I've also lost my, I lose my block that way. Although Minty is my next choice. I run the risk of, I don't like Bear Creek Station as much at all because it's off on the edge of the board, very, very much more in play for a block for being pinned back there. But that's what I'm going to try. He has 9 movement points. He's going to use them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I have to hope that. Yeah, he still has. No, I'm not going to make the same mistake twice. I'm going to stop in Lovejoy, keep Armstrong or somebody from slipping into Lovejoy and making me work even harder. All right, so Long stops in Lovejoy. He's not going to be able to burn it on F4. Because he's only 1 manpower, one combat value. All right. He's up to fatigue 3. Yes. All right. Next initiative is Union again. I really don't want to move these guys to fatigue 4. Although they're not exhausted, so it's not as much of a risk. But the unit's 1 north of Long, or I guess that's east, 1 east of Long are fatigue 3, so they run the risk of. All right, I'll take a gamble. Kilpatrick will activate just the big guy, Murray. So Kilpatrick activating Murray. I'm not going to roll for extend for movement. I'm not going to go to Bear Creek Station even if I can. Although actually, options. All right, so I will move, roll for movement. So Kilpatrick, 1 east of Long, is going to activate just Murray, my big unit. All right, here's movement. 6 plus 1 is 7. So I have my option of either going to Lovejoy or Bear Creek. And here's the extend march roll. I'm going to F4. Fortunately, they're not exhausted. So here's the extend march roll. Did I roll another 6? It looks like I did. All right, so he flips as well. So instead of going to Bear Creek Station, as I was thinking of doing, if he maintained his cohesiveness, going the wrong way, he's also a one-man power.
Dice are not being
combat turned, value. Yeah. So he's going. He's at 54. He's going to go and join Long in Lovejoy and Kilpatrick. I'm not sure it matters whether he moves with them or not. Let's see. Yeah, Kilpatrick will march in there. Do I want to do something fancy with another movement point and refuse flanks? It looks like it's going to be almost impossible to get anything more than a +1 surround on them, so no flanks refused. All right, so I have 2 combat value and Lovejoy. I can't burn this turn because I'm at fatigue 4 with one of the units, but I'm set up for next turn at least. All right, next initiative is to the Rebs.
Okay. Well, I know Mark's going to have to spend at least a couple more initiatives here on this side of the river just to burn that railroad station. At least one of Jackson's units is sort of anchored in place because he's at F4. And I like the way they're all within command radius right now. So I'm going to pass.
All right. I don't like the idea of moving Minty up to fatigue 3 because if he fails on that extension roll, which is a 1/3 chance, then he's gone for the rest of the game. He's eliminated. So I think I will... I only have 4 units now. It's easier to keep track. I will pass as well. All right. End turn 2.
Okay. I'll go ahead and hit the recover button.
All right. 4. Yep.
So we're starting turn 3, and you have leader transfer first.
I do. So Kilpatrick's special power, this... he needs to activate them. He doesn't need to be in the hex with the units to do a special burn with... combining 2 units together. So I'm just going to transfer Kilpatrick 1/1 hex straight up to join whoever that is, Klein, so that Minty at least is in his command radius. All right. Do you have a to the Rebs for their any leader transfer?
I'm going to move Jackson just over to Ross. And then I'm good.
All right.
So if you want to drop the first init, we can go for it.
All right, here we go. It's to the Rebs.
All right. Well, I think what I want to do is start making Mark's path home uncomfortable. So I think the best way to do that is to activate all 3 units and try to cover some of these Flint River bridges. So here is the movement roll for all 3 of Jackson's units. There you go. Okay, so I have 7 movement points. Move, transfer Jackson to Armstrong. And Ross will move first. He's going to go 2, 4, 5, 6, 7 to Turner. And somehow my manpower didn't follow me, so. There we go. And then Jackson is with Armstrong. And they will do 7, 2, 4, 5, 6. Block that bridge. And then Ferguson is going to have to make extended march roll. And here is that roll. Made it. So he's going to come here.
I do have two avenues home. I can go up north to up to Decatur as well. That route is also
that's interesting. Okay. If but that, you cannot
if
get
that means anything to you, but that is a that is, but you have a lot of mobility. You can move far and fast. So
and you can't get the points for Fairburn that way.
That's very true.
But you could get the points from our station.
You've got the slow Reynolds hanging around, but then if he abandons Jonesboro, then that would be open.
Yeah.
But the Rebs can move fast.
Well, I like how I've just gone to F1 with them, and they're all still within Jackson's command radius. So I'm going to stick with that move. So here's an it. Okay. And I think I'm going to keep my options open, so I'm going to pass.
All right. Kilpatrick will activate the two units in Lovejoy Station to do their burning thing. So they each go up to Fatigue 2. They don't have to. I'm sorry, one's at Fatigue 1 goes to Fatigue 2. The other's at Fatigue 0. Thank you for whoever found. Must be Ken, I'm sure. I just added. I'm adding manpower. I mean to be adding a fatigue marker to Long. All right, Long goes to Fatigue 1. All right, damaged. One unit F2, one at F1. All right. Next initiative is a high tie. That's the Rebs.
All right. I need to see which way you go, so I'm going to pass.
So we're on turn 3. I know there's not going to be any rain for the next couple turns, so that's good, at least. Pondering whether to... I'm going to need more points. Bear Creek Station. I'm going to need some good... disorganization extend march rolls if I want to burn that one, too. I got units at fatigue or exhausted fatigue 1. I only have two units that actually have one manpower. Definitely losing one unit makes it tough here in the late game. If I pass here, I can reconstitute some of my forces. I like the idea of getting Long back to non-exhausted, back to normal. Of course, I only have two turns to get everybody back, but they are cavalry. It'll be tight. The Rebs could see what I'm planning and try to occupy Bear Creek Station, but that would put them very widely scattered. Minty, he can march. But he won't have to. He gets a free march if I want without having to extend march. All right, I will march Minty. Kilpatrick will activate Minty within his command radius. Here's his movement. 8 plus 1 is 9. So Minty goes to fatigue 1, gains a fatigue marker. He has enough to get to Bear Creek Station. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now, of course, he's a half manpower. I'm sorry, half combat value, hanging up against a get map edge. So I think I will transfer Minty to him. Didn't have to roll for extend margin there, so I didn't have to announce that first. And why don't we stop there? All right. Next initiative is, gotta roll the same thing again, 6-2.
Yep, you're up again.
Let's see. I'm not gonna be able to, unless I get very fortunate on, I could march Murray into Bear Creek Station. He'd have to pass an extend march roll, in which case then I could do a burn in Bear Creek Station. Of course, if he fails the extend march roll, then I'm running out of forces to to do another burn.
You'd have to move both those units back there because Minty's only a half.
Oh, you're right. I cannot do it this turn. You're right. Good point. I'd have to get them both there. I have to get Klein there as well. So I've not moved Klein yet this turn. He's been hanging up to the north there. Or like the east. Okay, so Klein, he's all on his own, no leader. Klein will activate. Here's his movement roll. 10. He goes to fatigue 1. Does not have to roll for extend. He will join 2, 3, 4, 5. Join Kilpatrick, Bear Creek Station. All right. So I do have enough to burn that next turn, but not this turn if all stays the same.
I think you're only at 1.5. I think you actually have to be at 2. Is that correct?
Yes, I need to be at 2. I cannot. I'd have to wait till I get more forces in there.
Yeah, one more guy.
I'm hoping that next turn, if everyone passes soon, although the Rebs may actually respond to what I just did, but Minty, if he stays as he is, would gain his half manpower back since he's only at F1 right now. He'd become organized again for next turn. So then I would have 2. So at the beginning of next turn, I could do the burn. So that's what I'm trying to think ahead, but I have a feeling maybe the Rebs have some other plans in mind. All right, so next initiative roll is to the Rebs.
Yeah, this is an interesting position. That Bear Creek Station is a dangerous hex. Being caught between two woods is in the edge of the board. So it's very tempting to go up and try and see if I can block that. I think I kind of have to give it a shot. So Jackson's going to activate the two southernmost units, Armstrong and Ross. And we'll see how many movement points I get. It's going to be 8. All right, so he will march with Ross. Ross is going to have to make an EM check. Okay. So it's 7 movement points. So I go 4 to there, 5, 6, 7. And then Armstrong can go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Do you have 8 movement points?
I do. But I hit zone of control here.
Okay.
3. If he goes around this other way, he ends up in the star field. And And he's going to get dazed and confused by the star field, so I think I like him where he is right now better. It also means Kilpatrick's force is now split. They're no longer all within command radius. These guys are sort of pinned by the woods. Yeah, and I've got artillery with both those guys, so that's going to be a minus if he tries to attack. So yeah, I'm pretty happy with that. So we'll stick with that and run it. It's a union.
Yeah, I will. I'll pass.
Okay, so I think the one other thing I'd like to do, Ross is going to gain 3 fatigue levels, but he's going to stay exhausted no matter what I do. I think I want to entrench him just to make it, or else I could move him forward 1 hex, but then he's got to make an extended march check. And he would flip on a 5 or 6. Also would be susceptible to a flanking attack if I move him forward 1. So I'm just going to bump him up 1 fatigue level and once again add an entrenchment. All right, so we'll roll a mid again. It is mine. I know that if I pass, Mark is likely to as well. But I'm happy enough with this. I'll pass.
All right. I'll pass as well.
All right. So we've got 3 turns done.
All right. Turn 4. Getting late.
All right, so you could do a leader transfer.
I could, but unfortunately, as much as I wish Kilpatrick could have some, could be with the folks in Lovejoy, he's got to stay in Bear Creek to do the burn, so I will not transfer.
Yeah, and I'm not going to transfer either, so go ahead and roll the first init.
All right, it's Union. All right, so I will do, Kilpatrick will activate his 2 units and do the burn action.
All right.
Ken's in charge of the finding the railroad station damaged. All right. So another 9 points. I like that. It's just that now I've got to get these units back home. So currently I have 18 points from burns, and I've lost 2 and 3, 5 from losing my 1 unit, so I'm at 13 points if I can get everybody back, but that's a big if, perhaps. All right, next initiative to the Union.
That's potentially big,
so I'm definitely going to try to get myself out of Bear Creek Station here while I can, because if you stop those guys up, that's 4 and 5 points. It keeps escalating in the victory conditions. So I have to get at least 1 of those units back, I think. All right, so Kilpatrick will activate both Klein and Minty. They're going to have to go a rough route around here. All right, so here's their movement. 3 plus 1, 4. So they're not going to be moving very far. They're going for D2. They're fresh, not exhausted at least, so I don't have to roll. I would have liked to have been able to get out through that forest there. So I can either go up 1 north to the forest. It looks like it's about 6 of 1. I'm going to try to get out of the edge of the board. Yes, so they're all fatigue 2. It's along a road, so they don't have to worry about becoming disorganized, and now they're in, well, they're not in command radius of the Lovejoy forces because Armstrong is strategically placed in between there. All right. So I got them up to fatigue 2 and time for the next initiative.
Yep, roll it.
It's to the Rebs.
Okay, well, I was hoping I'd get one and I could move into Callaway before you got there, but that was not to be. So let's think about what the choices are. I could move Fergus. I don't think I want to move Reynolds quite yet because you could still get 9 more points for Jonesboro, which would be bad. If I move Armstrong, he's only got really 1 hex to go. And that's going to probably, that'd be 5620. That's not going to slow you down significantly. Just, you actually still have the same path north. I do have the option to attack and try to add fatigue to that way. But this is a 1-2 attack, minus 1 more for artillery, so it's at best a minus 1 attack. So that one's not attractive at all. Armstrong attacking over here. You don't have any artillery, which is nice. And I can transfer Jackson over, so I can get plus 1 prepared, plus 1 tactical. It'd be a plus 1 attack, but it could be pretty likely to DU. Or I can move Ferguson up and try to pin you first. And I think that's actually the best move, is to try to get Ferguson up here to Crawford to pin your stack here at Lovejoy Station. So we're going to move Ferguson. And here's the movement roll. Only 6. 1 short of what he needed. Okay, well, I'm pretty certainly going to move there with the first 4. He's not allowed to force march because he's already disorganized. So I really just have to decide where to take the other 2. And that'll pretty much have to be here. All right, so we'll do the next initiative.
All right, so things are getting a little tight in here. I could get Long out of Lovejoy, but then I'm in Murray's all alone. It's going to be hard to get more than a plus 1 flank on him, but he would be in jeopardy. He has a roads on the way out. So why don't I do that? Try to get Long out while I can. Unfortunately, Kilpatrick can't activate him. I'm tempted to move the Kilpatrick stack and get them into Lovejoy stack's command radius. If I don't get the next initiative, that could be a problem. So it's going to be the fresh Long, my big guy, who's got he's going to march. So Long, I just added a fatigue to him. So Long is going to try to exit Lovejoy. Here's his movement roll, 5, and it is 5 since he's not in command radius. All right, he's just going to start heading east. Whoops. All right, so 2 to there because I'm exiting Armstrong's zone of control. I could stay where I am, I'd be at least in within Kilpatrick's range. But 3, 4, 5. So he's going to start moving to the north or to the east, maybe threaten Morrow Station, get closer to home. I am risking Kilpatrick's stack becoming much less well protected. But all right, so that's what we'll do. And next initiative.
Yep.
Is Union again. So I'm getting a, so Kilpatrick will activate his two units, Minty and Klein. I'm hoping that the Murray unit in Lovejoy, well, I don't really want to lose him. If the Rebs spend too much time on him, they'll let the rest get away. And I think if even if Murray gets eliminated, I'd lose 8 points. That might be enough. I'm currently at 13. I have 7 points to give.
Be one short.
So I'd be one short. I lose 4 for this, getting the second unit, not for not getting a second unit back. And if I lost 2 manpower, that would be a problem. Then I'd have 4 more losses, so I'd be one short. All right.
That's so, how I count it too.
All right, so I will activate Murray. He's going to go to fatigue 1. So he will not have to extend march. All right, here's his movement. 10. I like it. So I'm thinking heading towards Decatur. Both threatens Morrow Station and I want to get home. Don't like my forces being all separate, but if they all go in different directions, I have a lot of trouble seeing. At the beginning, when I was looking over the scenario, seeing how the Rebs pin a whole lot of Union forces when they don't have many units. So if they all sort of go their own way, the Rebs sort of have to go ping-ponging back and forth between units. And let's see. So I get 10 movement points. Well, I'm likely to bring the burn with me here, the damage marker. There we go. So it's 2 to there. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. I think this is the shortest route to Decatur. It's just I risk being pinned in that direction. All right. So I'm starting to get my forces back, but Bear Creek group is a little problematic. All right. Did I do that right? Fatigue 1. All right. Next initiative is to the Rebs.
All right. Well, this is an important decision as to how I play this, I think, for sure. I think the key thing I have to do is try to keep these two guys from, with Kilpatrick, from getting out of here. And they're in my zone of control now. So if I get up to like 56-18 here, these three hexes, they'd have to stop because they're going zone of control. They could come around this way and get to 57-18. But that would be at fatigue 3. And I know that they wouldn't get any further than that this turn. Well, let me activate Armstrong from Jackson. And we'll just roll and see the movement. And then I'll try to come up with a position for him. Okay, so he's going to have 9 movement points. And I want to transfer Jackson because I'd rather get my leader sort of in the middle of my forces. So if I come 57-19. What I'm worried about there is Kilpatrick could slide one hex at fatigue three and then make a fatigue four move where he's just right out the main road. If I move Jackson here, then he could come to either 57-18 or 56-19. I guess he could still get to 56-19 and then make that same kind of move. If I position him here, let's see, and I have 7, 8, 9 movement points, so that would take 3 to get there. I'd have 6 left. I could try an attack, or I could just leave it be here. And at least this way, if he's going to escape out of road at fatigue 4, it's going to be this road up to the north. Okay, so that's where I want to be. Now I have to decide whether I want to attack.
I mean, I have the very unpleasant way out the due back to one hex to the above Bear Creek out the...
Oh, this way too,
up,
yeah.
Up the road, although it's there's a lot of cross-country movement there. It's going to take a lot of moves to get out of there.
I think that's not a bad reason, though, to go ahead and press an attack at this point. So let's see. It's a normal attack. I do have a +1 flank on you.
Is +1 flanks ignored if it's...
It would be a +2.
Oh, it's +2. It becomes +1. You're
so
right.
It becomes +1.
It's definitely +1, yes.
Now you have artillery, so, and you have more manpower. So it'd actually be a -1 attack. Definitely kind of risky. I think I'm just going to hold there and hope I win the next init, and then I can move Ferguson. All right, so initiative. That is yours, and no late rain.
Exactly. It'd be raining almost every day if, see. So, gosh, I'm tempted to let Kilpatrick just kind of fend for himself with his forces dig in and hope for the best and get long to do some more burning action in Morrow's Station. It takes so many Reb units to successfully pin. If Ferguson comes around, the road for Long is wide open to Morrow's, and then up north, Reynolds is sort of pinned himself, since if he leaves and I just go down to Jonesboro, Long is powerful enough to do burns on his own right now. But I could tempted to entrench Klein and Minty, make it even, get them up to even more, help things in my direction. But I am worried about getting retreat losses in a combat that causes that. So Kilpatrick will activate both Klein and Minty. They're going to make a run for it. So here's my movement roll for the two units with Kilpatrick. 8 + 1 = 9. So let's see. They started the turn fresh, did their burn activity. So they both go to fatigue 3. Both going to have to extend march. They're going to try to make a dash to the straight up the board here, up to McDonough. then they're on the edge of the board a different place, or they could go to Liberty Creek. I still have to extend march roll first, but playing out my move first. So Minty will extend march first. He's one of the units. So Minty, here's his extend march roll. 2, so he's good. I have 9 movement points. They're both going to, Kilpatrick will stay with the second unit. They're both going to stack together. Anyway, so 2 to exit, 3, 4, 5, 6. Sure wish there were a road over here somewhere to the left. 7, 8, 9 to McDonough. And now Klein will do the same thing, his extend march roll. 5, he's not exhausted, so he's okay, barely. And Kilpatrick goes with him, and he joins. Next initiative. Union again. Well, I guess I have my choice. I can either try to break the McDonough force free, or I can try to get the long group over to Morrow Station, do some damage, force the Rebs to start splitting their forces up. I think I'm going to break the McDonough group out. I don't like them being pinned up against the edge of the board, although I'll be at F4, and then they're at the mercy of the Rebs, who have a lot of initiatives left, fresh units, to try to beat up on them. All right, so Kilpatrick will activate Minty and Klein again. Here's their movement. 6 plus 1, 7. Again, I can't complain. But now I do have extend march rolls. All right, so I guess Kilpatrick is stacked with them, so he doesn't have to say who he's associated with until after I start moving them. So let's see, I will do the extend march roll for Minty. Minty first. Here's his extend march roll. He's going to have 4, so it's either a 5 or a 6. Okay, he's all right. One to there. Kilpatrick will stay behind. Minty has his own 2 command values, so he doesn't actually need Kilpatrick as much as Klein does in case I actually need to want to keep Klein short. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's not a bad hex. 1 more would be closer, but boy, a lot of creeks around there. A lot of creeks. You'd have to attack me from that wood hex. And I have protection from the woods in 57 land. I will go the full 7, 51, 11. The hex right below Minty provides a little flank protection because you'd have to get somebody in there to get that from being subtracted out in the final flank bonus. Now we'll activate, and now we will, I'm sorry, march Klein. Here's extend march. Did I really roll a 1 a second time? I guess I did. All right, so Klein's okay. He also goes to fatigue 4. Didn't actually change Minty to fatigue 4. Okay, fatigue 4. Stays organized. I'm at a crossroads, sort of. So that's good for being able to avoid retreat losses, but it's not out of the question that the Rebs couldn't come around and cause me some nasty retreat losses and do some real nasty stuff. unfortunately, like no more entrenching. We do have a couple good artillery. We're now in the clear, so that's going to help us with artillery. We have two artillery in the clear. That'll be an extra bonus there. All right, so I don't know if that's the best move or not, but we're going to stop there. And everyone's at F4 there. All right, next initiative is a high tie. That's the Rebs.
All right. I'm wondering whether I should have made that minus one attack, but minus one attacks, if I'd missed that roll by two, I would have taken a loss, and that would have been three more victory points I give up. So I think I probably played it right, but the units didn't favor me there. So we're going to have to get Jackson's two guys that are within his radius on the move, and we'll see what options we have. So I'll activate both of them. So that is going to be Armstrong and Ross. And they're going to get 11 movement points. So no more entrenchment. Let's go up a fatigue level. Neither's going to have to make an extended march check. I'm not sure who Jackson's going to march with yet. We'll check that in a second. So 2, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9. Yeah, I see a chance to hit long with a chance to get a retreat loss. So I'm going to have to do that one. That's too tempting. Okay, so Jackson will stay with Armstrong. Ross moves first, 2, 3, to go just past Armstrong along the rail line. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, to there, which is exactly what I have. And then 2, 3, 4, 5, to there. And so if I force Long to retreat, he's either going to have to retreat away from my unit, retreat priority 4, but he doesn't have a hex that has a road along it, or I'll have to retreat back towards me along a road. And so either way, he's going to take a retreat loss. Now, he is size 2, so that will not kill him, but the retreat loss will get me 2 victory points and hopefully put him in a difficult situation going into the last turn, or maybe I can mess him up some more. So this is going to be, I have 6 movement points left. It's a normal attack. It would be a +4 flank, but the woods backs out and a +3, and then cavalry on cavalry, that drops to a +1. So I think it's +1 for flank and +1 for tactical, and that's all I'm seeing.
Yep.
Does that sound right, Mark?
Yep, looks right.
Okay, so I'm going to roll the dice. It's going to be a USA first die and a CSIA second die with a +2. So I end up with a +3. And that's going to be big FA on me and big DR to you.
Right.
And so you're going to take that retreat loss. So let me flip you over and decrease your manpower.
Thank you.
You're going to go up to fatigue 4, and now I'll let you go ahead and decide where you want to retreat to.
So I have 2 options.
2 fatigue levels, so I'm done for the day. But I'll take that performance from Mr. Armstrong. So Ken, or somebody, you already marked the...
Yes, got it.
It's all a question of which way I want... Long to be heading for his long march home. If I move him in between Jonesboro and Lovejoy, he'll be prey for some more Rebs.
And you can only retreat him 4, not 6, because it was a small art result.
Right. Oops.
And he can't retreat through 4, 5, 1, 1, 6 because it's a restricted ZOC, or can he retreat through there?
Restricted ZOCs do not apply on retreats. Mm-hmm. So yeah, he cannot go through. If he goes to 5216, he'll have to then go to 5215.
Mm-hmm. I often spent more of my time on retreats than I do on movement, since it sort of plants them in place. And I try to figure out what the opponent is going to do if I plant somebody somewhere for the rest of the turn. I don't like the idea of planting long right on the Macon and Western Railroad there, because we've got units floating around there. Ross still has some activations.
Could he retreat to 4917?
I'm sorry, which four?
Yes, he could, I think. He could go pray at Noah's Ark Church and then continue two more into the woods to 4818. And then that fourth hex can be a slide, so he could go to 4917.
Right.
Or 5213 is an obvious option.
Right. 5213, 4917 is...
What I like about what just happened is I think I am free of worrying about railroad burns for the rest of the game. Because Murray... Well, actually, that's not true. If Murray does not move again, he will become manpower 2 for the final turn. And he could snipe Mar Station or Jonesboro. So I do have to still worry about Robert Burns.
But then he still has to all the way back to Decatur on the last turn.
Yeah. I'm not saying it's likely, but for a second there, I thought I didn't have to worry about it at all. But I don't think I want to give up the 9 points for Jonesboro.
So I'm going to head up and out of the way of the Rebs.
Okay, and I will go ahead and advance in. And let's roll the hit. Mine again. So let's see where we're at victory point wise. So he's got 18 on burns. He's losing 3 for the brigade that's not getting off. That's 15. He's losing 4 losses. So that puts him at 11.
Yes.
So I have to stop another brigade from getting off and then get one more victory point. So eliminating Long and keeping any more stations from being burned, I sort of have to do both. All right, so Jackson's going to activate Ferguson and Ross. And here is the movement. So that's 9. Okay, well, I really wanted 4615, but I think I'm one movement point short. Probably 2 movement points short. But what I'm going to do is Jackson will transfer to Ferguson. And Ferguson will make his extended march roll first. Okay. So he goes to fatigue 2. Goes down the road 9, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 to Morrow's Mill. And then Ross makes an extended march roll. He's okay. Okay, and so he's just going to come in behind, and I am trying to do exactly the same thing to Murray that I just did to Long, which would be if Jackson can come into 46-15 and hit him, Murray does not have a retreat route, and I'm hoping to get a retreat loss on him. I'm also hoping to add some fatigue to him so that then I really won't have to worry about any railroad station burns. The other good thing about this is even if I don't win this in next init, Mark's going to have to think about moving Murray, and he's kind of pinned up against the woods right now. So that's my move, and here's the init. There's Mark's.
All right. So clearly, Murray is in jeopardy, but boy, I have to worry about the next turn, getting these folks with enough initiatives to actually return in good order. Gonna have to pass a bunch of speed rolls and be fortunate in getting initiatives. Murray's only at F1. I was hoping to get him fresh for the next turn. If I move him into the woods, that's really the only place. All right, I will activate Murray. Here's his movement. Eight. Goes to fatigue 2. Which is six movement points to get into the woods and 1 to exit the hex. Here's an extend march roll. 3. He passes. That's 7. It's either there or adjacent to Jackson, and then I'm still pinned in there anyway. So we'll try to get out through the woods. All right. Next initiative.
Yep.
To the Rebs.
Okay, well, this is a little tricky because the way he's in the woods there, he can sort of come out in any direction and it doesn't count as a zone of control, the zone of control move. So he does sort of have a bit of an advantage that way. I do think I'm free to move Reynolds now, though, because Jonesboro can't really be burned unless Patrick comes back. I could even make a railroad move. I haven't even looked at where the railroad... I'm not allowed to move into Decatur.
No, you can't.
Texas, I think. There's a little... There's some
up to Atlanta in this area with a railroad move, right? But then, then trying to get back out in front of Decatur is going to be a little tricky. I think maybe what I do, I'm really worried about Jackson's cavalry. They're starting to all get to the point where they're very likely to flip if I move them. So I think I'm going to move Reynolds just for regular march. First time we've seen infantry march in the entire scenario. So here we go. And infantry is not looking very impressive on the march. It is Confederate, so it gets 2 movement points. I'll leave that there. I could force march him. No, I don't think it's worth it. All right, and it. Mine again. We'll move Reynolds again. Here's the movement roll. Still not impressive.
So since Reynolds can't attack Murray, I don't have the option for a cav retreat. But otherwise, with a infantry, I would have the, if he actually tries to march from right there, I would have the option. Right?
Yeah. Yep, that makes sense.
And describe why you can't attack him there, because you have to stop before you attack into a woods hex, right?
Right. You have to be adjacent to somebody to attack across a woods hex side, like this hex side here. And Murray doesn't block Reynolds' movement north along the road because his zone of control, but this is considered a woods hex side here. He's sort of in a hex that's considered to have woods on all sides of it. And so he doesn't have a full zone of control to block movement of Reynolds up to there. So I guess that's where we're going to end that movement, and we're going to roll a knit again. Okay, well, now I think I can, with those three units, do a pretty good job of pinning Murray. So, and I think we just need to move. If we move Jackson up to here. Then wherever Murray's going, he's going into my zone of control first, stopping. He won't go disorganized because he's coming out of a wood tech, so I sort of don't know where he is. It's not considered zone of control, zone of control. But then with this positioning, he doesn't have a good road immediately. So I'll do a minimum move with Ferguson, and here's the extended march. Okay, that was what I was afraid of. Well, I do lose a manpower. Okay, then it's initiative. Fine. All right, so if I attack Murray now, he's going to take a retreat loss if I make him retreat. Should be two more victory points. 15 minus 15. Put it down to 9. Then I just have to block one guy from making it off the map. I can't really attack with Reynolds because then he could just do a cavalry retreat. So it would have to be with Ferguson, but because he's stacked with a leader, I could try an assault. So it'd be a +1 for assault, +1 for tactical, -1 for odds, +1 for flank. I think it's a +2 attack. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to try an assault with Jackson.
And the advantage there is you don't have to roll for the extended march.
I was thinking it was a +3. I might be missing something there.
It's -1 for odds. I think it's only a +1 for flank because I don't have a full zone of control here, only a restricted.
Which one?
This one here.
Oh, 46-15. Good point.
Yeah, yep. Because I'm in the woods here.
Yep, 4615. There's no road connecting it with the Jackson hex. Yep.
So here's my assault command roll. He fails. Oh boy. We're having some fun here, Mr. Jackson, aren't we? Not the Jackson I want here, is this? All right.
A couple years ago.
Amit, you're up.
All right. I've got my work cut out for me. Clearly, only Ross is left as far as Cav to do an attack on Murray, and that's going to be very difficult for him to pull off this turn. I'm tempted to entrench Murray and let him hope people, the enemy goes away. I still have to get back units next turn. Only one turn left. Long way to go.
You're currently at 11 victory points. Not getting Murray home would be an additional minus 4.
Right.
So you'd have 7.
Just have to avoid any combat losses. Mm-hmm. I will entrench Murray. I'm not sure if this is a good move or not, but it's something. He goes to fatigue 3. It makes it a little harder to get that an abattis.
I got it.
A little harder for, you know, it's 2. So that's it. Next initiative. It's me again. I will pass. I only have 1 unit left with movement left.
Yeah, I'm going to pass too.
All right.
Leader transfers.
Yep.
You have one, Mark?
No.
Okay. Boy, it comes down to a lot of Anits here. First Anit's going to be pretty huge. I'm going to transfer Jackson back to Armstrong. He's been my man of the match. I'm hoping Armstrong can do it. All right. You want to drop the first init?
Sure. It is Union. All right, Long will activate. Here's his movement first, 7. He's got to extend march, going to F2. The first of many, hopefully. Here's his extend march roll. I think I did roll a 6. Uh-oh.
That's some hope.
Long just... Long just got lost.
So that's 4 more victory points.
All right. We're on the... that pretty much ends it since there's no way that Murray is going to escape.
Well, he's got a chance at it if you win the next couple of nits, I guess.
I suppose if I get about 3 nits in a row and roll some 7s on the last 2. All right. Thank you. Let's keep going. Next initiative roll is Rebs.
Okay. So if I can disorganize Murray, the game's over. And I think that's got to be my...
Just add a fatigue or 2 would be plenty, probably.
Yeah. Ferguson has a horrible attack, so I can't attack him this time, really, so I'm going to move Armstrong. So Jackson activates Armstrong. Okay, and so that is 12 movement points. I am going to have to make an extended march roll. He's okay. Okay, I think I want to go here. Just want to figure out if you start trying to slip through, I may need to cut you off to the east. If I go here, your best option is to go north. So that would be
fatigue
one, fatigue two. You can get up this way. Yep. So you have a path out if I don't win the next init, but
I'm not sure mathematically I have enough movement points to get to Decatur with slipping out the...
Yeah, we'll make you trigger that way. All right, so next init. All right, that's mine too. And I will not trust Jackson's command ability, so he will march with Armstrong. So here's the movement roll. Okay, so that's going to be enough for a prepared attack, but I'm going to have to make a even trickier extended march roll, and I do not. So, oops, wrong way. I increase this, but I flip this. Okay, so now it is an attack with a plus two flank, a plus one prepared, a plus one tactical, so that's plus four. But then I lose one on combat odds because if you're a baddest. Mm-hmm. So I get it's a plus three?
Yep, plus three.
Okay, so USA and then CSA roll plus three. It's a plus five result, so I think that ends this new
one. That ends it. Well done.
Very good.
Pin the Union well.
Very good, guys. Closing thoughts.
I love cavalry scenarios, and they play to my strength. That's what I've got a lot of experience playing. So I steered us towards playing this one, and that didn't disappoint me.
Yeah, this is a great scenario. I like cavalry, wide open movement, lots of different options. I had thought coming into this that if I was able to burn the two big ones, Lovejoy and Bear Creek, or certainly Jonesboro and one of the others, that would be very hard for the Rebs to stop the Union, but that is not the case.
It's Rebs a long way out.
Lots of good options. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, Bear Creek is tough up against the edge of the map there. I was worried, though, turn four, you got the Anits to sort of put some distance between you and I. And I think it was when I finally caught Murray and knocked him from a two-man power to a one that I started to see a glimmer of hope after that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I will question whether I should have gone into Jonesboro on turn two with the first initiative and gotten in there before.
That would have changed things up a bit. It would have been interesting. Then I might have had to make an early attack, so that would have definitely switched things around a lot. So yeah,
that's a string of initiatives, but yes, that would have changed.
I like
things.
The scenario a lot, though. I'm going to push for this to be included in some of our upcoming tournaments because it's not too long and it's got lots of good maneuver in it.
Yep.
Okay. Well, well played, gentlemen. Thank you very much for joining us. And thank you, everybody, for listening in. I still think we have about 15 people on the line. So we'll be doing this again in a month or so again. And Joe Balkoski has already volunteered to be one of the commanders. So hope to see a number of you back to join in next month. Thanks again, guys. We'll see you.
Thank you very much. It was very enjoyable to watch.